What's going on, guys? This is Rob, and if you're enjoying the content that I'm uploading onto my channel, then feel free to subscribe, and you can also offer suggestions on topics and characters and storylines and whatnot that we can have discussions on later on in this channel.
Members of the Rob Corps, we are here. World War Hulk. Now, I gotta admit, I was kind of on the fence about this. I was like, do I really want to do World War Hulk? I mean, this was before I even launched the Planet Hulk thing, because I'd been experimenting with like Red Hulk and that kind of thing, and a lot of guys really seemed to enjoy it. So I figured, why not just kind of go back from the beginning, from basically Planet Hulk, and move forward up through the chronology leading us into Red Hulk. So here's what we're gonna do. For the rest of this week, really until we finish the World War Hulk event, which should probably take us about a week or so, it should take the rest of this week anyway, going into like Saturday, World War Hulk is going to take the place of everything except DC Rebirth. So we're going to keep all the DC Rebirth stuff, but like classic Marvel, classic DC. Well, I think we might keep classic DC and do like Speeding Bullets or something like that, where Superman becomes Batman. Aside from that, like, you know, How to Kill Superheroes, things like that, the all new, all different Marvel Day. That's all just going to be World War Hulk, because it'll give us a chance to get caught up really, really fast and then turn around and go back to doing one Hulk video a week, you know, leading up to the launch of Hulk and all new, all different Marvel. So anyway, so World War Hulk is kind of like this coup de grace, right? It's the magnum opus. It's the final event of Greg Pak's run on The Incredible Hulk. And we know that because after World War Hulk was over, it was essentially Hercules taking up the mantle of Incredible Hulk. It was like the Incredible Hercules. Hercules being put into the role that would normally be played by The Incredible Hulk. Now, that was done just because of the fact that Hercules just never really had a place in Marvel Comics. And so Marvel was doing the best they could to give him a place to stay. The issue is that it didn't last very long. And a lot of people didn't really like it too much. It had some cool stories like Chaos War, which is insanely awesome. But aside from that, there wasn't really a whole lot to go with there. But World War Hulk initially opens up with the North American Aerospace Defense Command Outpost, which is actually in Cheyenne. And this is really cool because, of course, when we had our Planet Hulk event, our Planet Hulk story, at the conclusion of that, we had talked about how the Incredible Hulk had taken a ship with his warbound and basically moved or made his way towards the planet Earth. And this is them essentially just realizing that the Incredible Hulk is coming. Now, initially, they don't know it's the Incredible Hulk. Instead, they just know that it's a ship. Now, the issue with this is that it begs a lot of questions with regards to, you know, how people don't know it's the Incredible Hulk. For example, in Marvel Comics, they have an organization called SWORD, the Sentient World Observation and Response Department. And this is literally just an organization that monitors other worlds. Now, because it monitors other worlds for, you know, potential threats, it just simply may not have registered the fact that the Incredible Hulk was there, or they didn't care. They just simply saw a ship. But you would think that with a ship of unknown origins heading towards the planet Earth, that somebody would stop to ask a question and say, hey, does anybody know what's going on with that ship right there? Because it's big and it's heading here and we don't know what's on it. So, you know, the fact that that didn't happen begs a few questions, but at the very least, it was just for the sake of storytelling. But the fact remains here that we essentially pick up on the moon, the blue area of the moon. Now, this is a big deal because what this does is this ties into the existing chronology of the Inhumans back before, back before all new, all different Marvel. With the Inhumans, during Paul Jenkins' run of the Inhuman event, which was like, you know, Inhumans Volume 2 or Volume 3, I think. This was essentially a set of events whereby Black Bolt had orchestrated a massive duping. He had basically just duped the Inhumans and tricked them into leaving Earth and going to the blue area of the moon. And that's where the Inhumans have been the entire time. Now, for those of you guys who don't know, the blue area of the moon is this oxygen-rich part of the moon. It's literally a section of the moon where you can walk around without any measure of protection and you can breathe just fine. It's actually a huge talking point in Marvel. Like, a lot of people have been there. Apocalypse has been there when he kidnapped Nathan Summers, who went on to become Cable, or the X-Men have visited there a multitude of times. It's a huge staging ground, like a huge battleground in the history of Marvel's publications. They always return there in some form or fashion. But the Incredible Hulk coming here is due to the fact that Black Bolt was part of the Illuminati, because remember, he's waging a war against the Illuminati here. Now, with regards to Black Bolt, his voice, his quasi-sonic scream, has varied over time in terms of how strong it is in Marvel Comics. There's been times where it's been shown capable of destroying planets. There's been times when it's only shown capable of destroying like a small satellite, like a small planet or a small moon or something like that. In this instance, his voice is, if I recall correctly, is kind of in the middle of the ground where it's not strong enough to destroy a planet, but it is strong enough to destroy a moon. Now, when I say his voice is in the middle ground, I mean, if he were to just kind of whisper or talk at a normal rate, regardless of what writers do or regardless of where he's been at in his publication history, if Black Bolt were to scream as loud as possible, he would wipe out out a planet. I mean, it's always been that way. Like, if he screams as loud as he can, that planet will be destroyed. With the Incredible Hulk being here, as soon as he shows up, you know, when he tells Black Bolt, like, dude, I'm going to take you out. Like, I'm going to destroy you. Black Bolt simply just kind of whispers enough. And it does enough to basically damage, you know, the Incredible Hulk, or at the very least, it seems like it does enough to damage the Incredible Hulk. But then we learn in one of the most awesome scenarios possible, the Incredible Hulk says, I didn't come here to hear you whisper. I came here to hear you scream. And I was like, this is so badass, because it's just the way it's done. It's just, it's insane how cool this looks. So from here, it's essentially the scenario where the government begins to become aware of the fact that something bad is happening. Not only that, they have literally chunks of the moon just breaking away from orbit. And so their question is, what in the hell is going on the moon that there's a conflict so massive that it's sending chunks of the moon into space itself? Now, one other thing to keep in mind here, and this is something that we'll touch on a little bit more as we get into this, but Tony Stark is currently the director of S.H.I.E.L.D. This is after Civil War. This picks up relatively soon after the conclusion of Civil War. So we still have the initiative, the 50-state initiative, where we have a superhero team in all 50 states. Not only that, of course, we still have the Illuminati as we knew them before. And so it's essentially this scenario where the world is coming to the realization that the Incredible Hulk is about to unleash hell. And this happens when the Incredible Hulk broadcasts himself to the world. And what he does is he essentially tells the story of what the Illuminati are. Now, keep in mind, again, the Illuminati always operated behind the scenes. No one ever knew who they were. No one even knew they existed. The only people that were aware of the Illuminati were the Illuminati themselves. Now, this all changed. Really, they came to light during both this World War Hulk event, and even more so during the events of Jonathan Hickman's Avengers and New Avengers, when they were basically public enemy number one in the eyes of Steve Rogers as the director of S.H.I.E.L.D. But the idea here is that the Incredible Hulk's essentially saying, you call the Illuminati heroes, you call Mr. Fantastic, you call Iron Man, Black Bolt of the Inhumans, Doctor Strange, you call them humans, they shot me into space. They didn't give me a trial, they didn't give me, you know, they didn't give me a chance to make any kind of case for myself. Instead, they duped me onto a satellite, and then I got into a ship. They sent that ship, you know, across the galaxy. I ended up in a, you know, going through a wormhole, ended up on this planet called Sakaar that was literally a war world. And the result was that, you know, while I did form a bond with what the Hulk refers to as his warbound, the fact remains that he found a life for himself, but then a bomb went off because of the ship as it was designed by the Illuminati, which resulted in him losing everything he had. And so he gives them an ultimatum. And this is really cool, because what the Incredible Hulk is going to do is he's going to turn New York City into a gladiatorial arena. It's badass when he does this. He says, you have 24 hours to hand over Reed Richards, Doctor Strange, and Iron Man, or I'm going to do this to every single person that I find. And he literally holds up Black Bolt. Now, the kicker about this is what's kind of ironic, is that not everyone knows about Black Bolt. Again, this really changed during Jonathan Hickman's Infinity event, when Black Bolt had detonated the Terrigen Bomb and basically caused the Terrigen Mist to spread across the world, waking up in humans everywhere. But the fact that one of Earth's superheroes has basically been ripped to shreds by the Incredible Hulk, been pummeled to the point where he's been absolutely obliterated, is an indication that the Incredible Hulk is not screwing around. Now, again, keep in mind here, despite the fact that Hulk is talking with a calm voice, despite the fact that Hulk is talking with a calm, relaxed tone, he's pissed. I mean, he's insanely angry. Now, he's not as angry as he's going to be at the end of the story, but at this moment right now, the Incredible Hulk is a force to be reckoned with. The other half of this equation is, with Tony Stark being the director of S.H.I.E.L.D., he immediately takes off. He says, okay, fine, we've got to find some way to deal with this. We got to find some way to cope with the Incredible Hulk, because if we don't, he is going to tear everybody apart. Not only that, the idea is maybe we can rationalize with him, maybe we can talk him down, maybe we can figure out what it is that's going on. And so what happens is Doctor Strange initially appears to Tony Stark and says, hey, look, we need to have a contingency plan. In case things go south, we need to have someone that can basically fight on our behalf, or at the very least can go toe-to-toe against the Hulk. And so what they do is they go and they visit Robert Reynolds. Now, Robert Reynolds historically has, his powers have kind of fluctuated. His powers have kind of changed. You know, I have videos on him if you guys want to. You're welcome to check those videos out. But the underlying theme here is that Robert Reynolds is one of the few characters in the Marvel Universe that can go toe-to-toe with the Incredible Hulk, that can stand against him. And so the idea of the Illuminati is to have Robert Reynolds come to their aid, come to their side, and fight on their behalf. The issue with this is that Robert Reynolds is actually not going to do that. Now, from here, we pick up with some of the minor superheroes, really not minor, but in terms of like overall strength, in terms of abilities, minor characters. We, of course, have Spider-Man. We have She-Hulk stepping into the fray, and they're really not fighting here so much as they're helping to orchestrate this mass evacuation of New York City. Because again, you know, when the Incredible Hulk showing back up here terrifies the hell out of everybody. not just because it's the Incredible Hulk, but again, because he has the strength to level the entirety of New York City. And so what we do is we basically switch over to Iron Man Tony Stark. Now again, he's meeting with Luke Cage, he's meeting with Doc Samson, She-Hulk, Wonder Man, Simon Williams. I mean, a lot of these heroes that cannot just absolutely cannot go toe-to-toe with the Incredible Hulk. And he basically says, hey, look, you know, he's going to come here, you know, but when he does, I'm not going to let him just walk all over us. I'm going to fight him. You know, I'm going to do what I can to hold off the Incredible Hulk. Now, again, Tony Stark has his Hulkbuster armor. And this is really, really important because there have been a couple moments in the Marvel Comics storylines when we've seen the Incredible Hulk go against Hulkbuster. This one and Original Sin. Original Sin, I think, did it much, much better in the sense that the Incredible Hulk was at about the same level as he is right now during his Worldbreaker Hulk form. And the idea was that he basically mocked Tony Stark. You know, Tony Stark went against the Incredible Hulk in Original Sin with his Hulkbuster armor, and Hulk just kind of laughed at him and said, you know, his toys, you know, Tony Stark always has his toys and they're always amusing, but they don't stand a chance against the Incredible Hulk. And that's exactly what happens here. Try as he might, the Hulkbuster armor is able to hold things out for a while. Tony Stark is able to do reasonably well against the Incredible Hulk. The issue with this is that when it all comes down to it, Tony Stark just doesn't have it. Tony Stark just does not have the ability to hold on to it. Now, the reason for this is because I'm going to make a really terrible analogy here, and I hope it works. For those of you guys who are Dragon Ball Z fans, you guys know that in the younger days of the series, Gohan was like this character where it's like every once in a while, something will happen, he'll just lose his shit, and his power will just fly off the charts for a temporary amount of time. That's what happens with the Incredible Hulk here. His Worldbreaker form, or at least the super angry, you know, unstoppable force Incredible Hulk, doesn't really come until like the very end of the story. But right now, he's still like insanely stronger than he's ever been before. He's well beyond the limits that he's been at previously in his publication history. But as he's fighting Tony Stark, he begins to have these flashbacks to the time that he spent with Kyara. He begins to have flashbacks to the love that he felt for her, to the fact that he was going to be a father, and to the, you know, imminent destruction of Kyara when the bomb went off. And this just sends him right over the edge. It really kind of like rejuvenates this anger that he has. And he immediately takes it to Tony Stark and starts ripping his Hulkbuster armor apart. Now, this is why I say the World War Hulk storyline is so cool, because under normal circumstances, if Tony Stark were to go against the Incredible Hulk with his Hulkbuster armor, he'd be able to hold out the Hulk long enough that either Banner would just lose interest and walk away, or he would just not really tire out, but it would allow other heroes to come into the fray and talk, you know, the Incredible Hulk down, or it would allow the situation to be resolved without a massive amount of destruction. That's not the case here. The Hulk just keeps getting angrier and angrier and angrier, and Tony Stark just keeps pissing him off more and more and more until it gets to the point that the Incredible Hulk has effectively destroyed Tony Stark's Hulkbuster armor and just kind of left Tony Stark there on his own to figure out what in the hell he's going to do. Not only that, it allows the Incredible Hulk to take Tony Stark prisoner as his first, or I guess his second victim in his campaign to take out the Illuminati as part of the Earth's superhero roster. But with that being said, we're going to bring this video to an end, and in the next video, we'll focus on what happens, at least I believe it's the next video, we'll focus on what happens when the Incredible Hulk turns his attention to the X-Men. But if you guys are new here to Comics Explained, make sure you guys hit the subscribe button to become part of the Rob Corps. If you guys enjoyed this video, make sure you drop a like and leave a comment down below. Let me know what you think about World War Hulk. I can't talk right now. Let me know what you guys think, and I will catch you all later. Peace.